small contribution to fight epistemic injustice that existed throughout the human history and humanity. So all those practices that you are going to present, that we are all going to discuss, are going to be a small footnote to contribute to the body of knowledge in the future, which is going to be more just, more equal, more, representing the real diversity of the humanity. And finally, this last title, subtitle of the conference, Questioning North-South Relations and Ethics of International Collaboration, is something that for us, being not really in the global north, but not really in the global south. When my colleagues from South Africa wanted to make a cultural policy researcher group of global south, they invited me to be guest observer. I said, but I'm from global south. They said, no way. You are part of the global north. You are part of the privileged world. We don't feel that way. We feel, however, but we have to say that we understand. Seeing now, over this conference, what were difficulties and obstacles from our colleagues from Africa, from Asia, to come, to get visa, to be heard in our embassies, not in Schengen embassies around the world that we always criticize, we realized that, yes, the world is far away of equal, and it's far away of just and equal, fair cultural cooperation. So I'm very glad that we are going to contribute with different discussions to all these issues. And now I ask my colleague, Sarah Cordonnier, to present the conference aims and sense.
Yes, to see you and to have the honor of spending the next 3 days with you. I'm Sarah Cordonnier from the University of Lyon 2. I had also the great pleasure and honor to coordinate this shaking project, shaking for sharing subaltern knowledge through and for cultural, international cultural cooperation. And as Milena said, this conference is the final event of this project by now. Maybe we will continue later. And so it's an event that has been made, within a collective. It's the first thing that I want to mention, international cooperation. That was part of questioning and things that we wanted to promote, to ease, but international cooperation is always really difficult. And in the case of this event, I have to say that the Belgrade team was really the foundation of this event, and especially Milena Dragicevic she's really the spirit of this event, and I want to thank you for this event, for the organization, for the inspiration, and also for all the tasks that are involved with the preparation of this event. So thank you, Milena, and thank you also for the invisible team that made it possible. So this event is, in a way, in its design, but also in its content, in a way, it's some kind of a result of our reflection, but it's not only that, because a lot of you will contribute to the reflection and to further implementation of what we thought about during 3 years and even 4 years within the project. And so for this, this conference, maybe you noticed that, and I think that the standards of this conference are really high. The standards for the quality, the expectations from you, who will present results, reflections, questions, ideas, ways of doing. So the standards are high, but not in a traditional, for instance, academic way. They are high with our own, in our own terms. And I think it's part both of what we try to do, what we try to reflect upon during the 3 years, and what we really want to further develop. Why are the standards high from our own perspective? Because we wanted in this meeting, which is called conference, we wanted that everyone that feels the need of the need to contribute would be welcome. Be there a researcher, artists, activists, students, and so on and so forth. So we wanted that everybody could express themselves with through their own voice, their own formats. So this conference, in a way, is kind of heterogeneous because there are classical research papers, but also workshops, artistic propositions. And for us, I think that it's really important to address the question dealing with subaltern knowledge and the way to make room for the subaltern perspective in our own respective places. What is at stake here is to find ways to hear each other, because it's not always easy to pay attention to other forms, other ways of speaking, of doing things. So to hear each other, to acknowledge each other, and to be moved by what others have to say. And it would be, from various perspectives, as a way to make room or to reflect upon the way that we can change our ways of doing things. And especially, I would say, maybe this heterogeneity in a way of the conference, I would say in my own words, it's a way for us to tackle categories, to reflect upon categories and the way that they frame our experiences, and to reflect upon, some lines, some continuities, and some opposition, for instance, between art, activism, research, professionality, study, or between theory, experience, emotions, inquiry, practice, or between relating to knowledge, which is really in the center of our project and of this conference, what is learning, sharing, doing, including unlearning knowledge. So I won't go into the details of the shaking project now, because later this morning we will have a whole panel to present the way we reflected, we worked together, and hopefully to have a discussion with you to answer your questions, if you have questions about what we've done those last 3/4 years. But by now, just before concluding, I just want to say that I think that maybe you feel some frustration in front of this beautiful, magnificent program, and nobody will be able to attend the whole program, so it's sad. But it's part also of the desire that we want to attend what we can't have it all. But I'm sure that these 3 days, and I hope for us collectively, that these 3 days will bring us inspiration, but also strength, tools, and also new energies. So thank you very much to you all. Thank you again, Jelena, and I will leave the floor to you again.
In fact, the Ministry of science and research excused for not being able to come, but our lector, Professor Dr. Mirjana Nikolic, will now take a word and open the conference. Please.
Only a few words for official opening. Dear colleagues, dear students, on behalf of the University of Arts in Belgrade, it is my great pleasure to welcome at the conference with this long and very contained name, which is organized by UNESCO Chair in Culture Policy and Management of the University of Arts. As the University of Arts, we are very proud that this conference is gathering about 150 participants from the whole world, is organized within the framework of the Erasmus, European Erasmus Plus Strategic Partnership Project, sharing subaltern knowledge through international cooperation or shaking. This project was initiated in 2020 by three universities, University Lumière, Lyon 2, Bauhaus University Weimar, and the University of Arts in Belgrade, UNESCO Chair, and also the three civil society organizations, Stockholm Museum of the Women's History, Le Lava from Bordeaux, and Association Independent Culture Scene of Serbia in Belgrade. The shaking participants began to work together already in 2019 with a collective need to address issues of exclusion, depoliticization, decolonization, and all ethical issues related to international culture collaborations, trying to find ways to equip students and younger professionals for dealing with these issues. Those questions are even more crucial now in our post-pandemic context. Cultural policy, cultural management, artistic research, and more widely the academic and artistic fields have been affected by huge transformation linked to the market and consumerism logic, the rise of populism, globalization process, ecological crisis, and digital transformation. Thus, the Shaken project went beyond the academic sphere, engaging cultural practitioners, artists, and artistic collectives. We are very proud of the fact that we have here today distinguished scholars, theoreticians, and artists from country and abroad. Specifically, we express thanks to our keynote speaker, Basma El Hassani, Husseini, Action for Hope from Beirut, Gertrude Dombry, writer and theater director from Guadalupe, which will be with us via Zoom online, as well as an activist artist, Tanya Ostrich from Belgrade and Berlin, who through a lecture and film project will raise numerous issues related to migration, feminism, and human rights. At the end, I would like to express my appreciation to colleagues from the UNESCO chair, especially to Professor Milena Cesic and her team, for organizing this conference that will discuss and share ideas, analysis, and experience in order to create a theoretical framework for the future curricular development based more on values of equality, solidarity, caring, humanity, and empathy. In the name of the University of Arts, I wish you successful work and interesting debate in few next days. Thank you.
We can't build a beautiful theater with a beautiful floor, wooden floor, and with all the money that it needs. But we have to do small things like this and tell these people, well, all the things that are around, that are our environment, are useful, and our water is precious. And so all these people who are doing all these little things around the world are necessary, they are important, and there we are in the system, we are fighting against the system. That's what I feel. Thank you.
Received her master's degree in acting at Faculty of Drama Arts in Belgrade and master's degree in Cinema Studies at Stockholm University's Swedish Film Institute. She continued her PhD technology in Belgrade. Since drama art graduation, she has been working as an actress, director, a producer at national theaters in Serbia, Montenegro, Yugoslavia, and in Sweden at the Royal National Theatre in Stockholm, Dramaten, on film and TV also, and she is currently at final year of her PhD scale studies. Her paper is entitled Nordic Film Engagement in Collective Noir Imaginaries. So a very interesting topic. Please continue.
Thank you for the introduction. And I can always connect with my colleague before. I'm somebody who is also struggling to make a huge division between art in the cinema like art, and everything else which is media, even including movies. So it's like my big job what I'm doing. I did actually master from low budget to big business in America, from independent film production, Boys Don't Cry, and somehow continuing the same pattern, but I moved now in Europe because America was like far away, even in Sweden, since I was living here until 1998. And then now it's 25 years that I'm living in Sweden and still living. So from Swedish perspective, I say, okay, I will not take care about Balkan, I will move myself to America just to see pattern, since the Oscar is there. Let's see what means independent movie there in relation to the Hollywood, which is like, you know, everything, like machinery of all kind of things. And now I'm in Europe, since I'm living now in Sweden, I was thinking to make a huge research in European movie, then we find out it is not important, it is not possible. Then I said, okay, let's start with the Nordic movie as a part of the European film heritage. So, here we are. And also these topics, let me see how to deal with this. Yeah, here. Crime thriller fantasy is something which is crime thriller fantasy like genre. And Nordic noir is part of that. It's like globally recognized TV and film genre, which often confirms and medially multiplies the image of hegemonic relation. Well, I put these subjects in this whole conferences in that level. So we have some kind of cliche pictures that are imaginaries that are just repeating. It's a relation of the Northwest toward the European and global South East. So what is important now, and even more important after the third, May 3rd now, which we had for 1 month ago, I really applied for this subject much before, because I'm doing my PhD in the subject, and then I find out, okay, well, it's a very burning subject to speak about. So instead of taking analysis of TV series, because all the theoreticians are just taking this, which is product of the product of the product, commercial cliche, entertaining, audio, visual genre use, I turn my research to the genre origins, since in modernity, if we are studying our cinema studies, genre is always made by like struggle of author's film. Somebody's doing something and then become very commercial or popular, then we are making genre of that, and then start some kind of misuse of everything. So, Nordic authors, Spielberg, searching for the roots of Scandinavian culture in identity through the history, geopolitics, religion. It's like some kind of otherness, which is very important. Literature, philosophy, which made this northern like wave, which we know here like 70s in Serbia, but it's totally different. How can I say, perspective? When I heard first time Nordic noir, I said, what? Crime fiction, is it noir? But okay, it is. After a while, when I find out what did this mean, actually. Because our black way is like political struggle to come out with some another truths, histories, and things like that. Okay, aim is to recognize Nordic noir implies multi-layered and authentically rooted cinematic experience through the crime modern Europe. which is paradigmatically connected to the crime thriller fantasy genre, which perpetually, position perpetual, it's like eternal, creates the modernism of Nordic cinema. From the early beginning, Victor Sjöström, Mauri Stiller, Dreyer, who is studying, they know that they has actually this dark thoughts even in that time from a very early beginning. Some term which I take as mine is amalgamation, which means that specific uniting process. For physician, it means like you take jiva. It's jiva. Do we know how the
mercury?
Mercury is the only material which is putting metal inside of them and making liquid. So metal structure becomes the same, but it's the same structure, but it becomes liquid. So it's not hybridization, it's not merge, it's not this all types. It's something, amalgamation is very, very specific, since metal is a structure, it still has the same structure, but in a liquid, so it's different. And then I find out it's vertical and horizontal. Vertical is like a hard climate and landscape, which you cannot avoid if we are talking about North. It's like sunny time until 11 o'clock these days, because it's midsummer. and it is also time of suffering, which has connection with, we should say from our like Christian tradition, like suffering and maybe religion or some metaphysical relation to existence. And horizontal direction, which actually globally is recognized as a colonial, racial, and hegemonic. So keywords, colonialism, racism, hegemony, Nordic authors, film, and Nordic noir. Hypothesis is the third wave of modernism in Nordic authors' film, starting from Dogma, 1985. Balint is one author, which I'm using, because he is one who made this author, telling that almost with the wall, Berlin Wall fall, it's like the end of the second wave. And then we are actually starting the third wave. And from my perspective, watching Nordic country, it's like Dogma 95. I can imagine Lars von Trier, Thomas Vinterberg. It's like big deal then. And actually, the problem with Bergman is there, but we don't need to mention since we have just a limited time. Bergman puts quite high level to jump over him after his whole heritage in the cinema. That's why Bergman is like, we don't speak about Bergman, we are speaking about new Nordic cinema. And this Nordic noir is actually stripped down existence, mystical power of the human soul through the breaking the chain of Viking time, racism, like heritage, racism, colonialism, including neoliberalism, by reestablishing of new old Nordic identity, grounding in irresistible search for freedom and global human values. And I will try to do that through the theory analysis of this all theoretical ground we have. I mentioned here, but through the case study of two movies, I choose these two movies for this. It's like Thomas Vinterberg and another round, white male drinking in the best age, like 50, and it won like a can. It was like irresistible, it's not possible prize. And Ruben Östlund, probably you know, Triangle of Sadness, which is also breaking through this pattern of successful movies. So I choose them. And as I said, Michael is a theoretical analyst and following this embalmed, which I mentioned in the ground. Why Winterberg in Oslo? I didn't choose movies which are like small stories in a local narration. I just put the movies which passed through got the prizes in Cannes and in Oscar also, for the Oscars. So how this pattern of their filmmaking today, after the Dogma, including Dogma and the new way of thinking, passed through. And as I said, it will involve more movies for the PhD, but for this presentation. I just chose these 2 months. Well, geopolitical is a very important part of identity. Scandinavian Nordic is not the same. Nordic countries is like linguistically, culturally, geographically, and partly politically. It's like, it's from our perspective, since the same, bunch of the same, as from the Nordic country, like bunch of the same is like Balkans. So we have like almost the same pattern, but in a different way, cultural codes, I should say. But there is quite a lot of differences and very special specialties inside them. So Denmark is part of Europe, even in fashion. You will find out that they are like more like common fashion, but if you come up, it's like everything is like clean, easy, nothing, I mean, special Swedish or Nordic design, as you probably mentioned that. So sea, water is something which is dividing them. Sweden and Denmark is said as a Piemont of the Nordic civilization, let's say, which Finland, with Finno-Ugric language, and Norway, which still has the same language, but still was under, we can say, different conquerors during the, I mean, neighbors, from neighborhood. And they are mostly Sweden-Russia conflict, historically, and Sweden, Denmark, and Germany, it is like an eternal conflict, I mean, historically, not last for 200 years since they are very proud, at least Sweden, about their neutrality. So, Northern West, as I explained, it's not the same, but something is very important, that if we take a last step to the America, which we are not thinking about. When I came there, I was thinking, okay, they love America because like they like Ronald Reagan. No, they have historically connection with America since during the 19th century, 1800, they move a lot to America. Even this question, Vikings probably discover America much before Columbus, but it is not historically like something which we're talking about. Immigrants, the William Moberg, it's like anthological work, film made 71 in 2022, is something which is showing, describing this situation. So, there is huge connection. We are talking southwest, I mean southeast and northwest. America is part, like genuine part. You know, you have a lot of Johnson, you have Swenson, even in Sweden, even in America, it is not without reason. And Stoltenberg is not where he is because he's from Norway. And yes, Russia is Russian, and me, I need to speak about that. Well, something which we must account is like a history from the ancient time during the Viking period. It's like darkness, cold, difficulties in finding food, lack of heat from the sun. This is something which we just don't think about. We just think about standard, and they are living like in a dream, like something which the rest of the world don't have. Yes, last 50 years. Because in the beginning of last century, it's like probably meat, but anyhow, it's a huge hunger there, and they say that we send the food there. It's not correct. But anyhow, it is the time of poverty and culturally some kind of, I will not say darkness, but anyhow, not so vivid as in Europe. And also something too is North was never a goal for any potential conqueror or individual movement there. It's also just part to conquer and go further to something else. It's got good strategically to move to Russia or to move to America. Something which is making a mess hard for us to understand is why today we are talking about more socially stable country with a high standard, the phenomenon of social superiority, emphasized interpretation of, okay, but how they did it, probably with the barbaric past, through the Vikings, racial ideology, which is elements of colonialism which we are talking about. Something which also belongs to today is national identity. It is almost forbidden to emphasize local national identity. And me, who is coming from Balkan, from Serbia, my parents are from Montenegro, to not deny our own identities. Like, what do you have a problem with since you have a huge history? No. And it means like hegemony. But when you are coming, when you are diving a little bit deeper, you will find out that there is a history which they are not so happy to speak about. So it is okay not to speak about identity. Well, these days, there is 500 of, let's say, Swedish national country, like a kingdom, because Gustavasa, it's like 6th of June, was crowned, and 24th of June, yesterday, or 2-3 days ago, he entered the Stockholm, or he defeated, made free Stockholm. So in his 500, and nobody's speaking about it. Nobody, you can find just some lines here and there, just because no. In the same time, you have a minority, a lot of refugees and people that are came from outside, and they are proud about their identities, and then you have clash. They don't speak about themselves. Suddenly we are talking about all another nationalities, and we have a little problem. So theoretically, Vikings, hegemony, racial study, we are going there now. Decolonial study, because everybody is speaking, especially if we are talking about Nordic, then we have a cliche that North-West are talking about South, which is always the low, poor, ugly, dirty, bad guys and girls, to most guys. So when I dive a little bit more in this colonial idea, well, they are not in a common sense colonial country, which we have England, France, Spain probably, because if we speak about the biggest colonial country for them, it's probably England, and then we cannot speak from Viking times. And if you are talking about conquering the rest of the world, okay, but it is not even in the same way which we are talking about, if we are talking about India, probably Africa, and this stuff. So decolonial perspective, it's quite, extensive and very flexible. So question is, I'm not sure that we have a fast ground, solid ground to speak about regarding refit, and as I said, it's like otherness. It is interesting just from another perspective, which we'll take. And I think that something is right there. It's like more, if we are talking about the colonization, it's like mindset, and Ash is an MD, sorry. She find out that colonialism primarily a matter of consciousness and should be defeated at the end in the mind of the people. So making theory, if we don't have a stable ground, for me it's a little bit too, something which is, I will take this part, but as I said, from this perspective, and Žižek I'm taking here, like critics, not of the content, more of the methods, when, how, why, it's different. But they have another part which is more stable or ground to go further in theoretical researches. It's like right wings, it's this like nationalities, nationalism, Nazism, and things like that. And then we can speak, Dylan is going about that, and he's speaking like 200 years before. He started that they have movement against immigrants, Swedish Danish Association. You still know that this one, that Danish guy who is burning the Quran. Are you following that Quran? It is also funny from us in Sweden, like he's burning in front of the Turkish embassy and nobody's dealing with something. They're waiting to come in NATO, but it's the democratic state and you should not do anything. And this Danish guy is doing his performance, and in the same time, police is there and Turks are, you know, against and things like that. It's quite crazy right now in Sweden. But something which I will not say lie, but something which has happened is that Sweden Democrats, which are like fascist party, I find out in this research paper, now is the one-third part of the leading part is there. And it happened just in the two elections before. They start for 6 years ago, like, I don't remember, 10 or something, 6, 10, or 3, probably even more, 10, yeah, okay. And now they're like 23%. And the all other parties, moderates and socialists, is also not so huge, like 25. So, but what they did to keep these fascist terms regarding them, it's they don't give them more voice in parliament. They're having their positions, but they cannot come out how they think. And I listen to them. They have a little bit hard. It is hard to listen. But somehow some deeper idea is like come back to the identity, come back to themselves, because the door is wide open and they are not dealing with that. It is quite huge energy to do that. Something which is also part, which belongs to this theoretical frame, is like racial research, which is very famous, that the Scandinavian countries, during the 18th and 19th century, there is a lot of centers. I was also interested in that. It was in Russia, it was on Balkans, it was in America, but this in Scandinavia is like most prominent, especially in the cranial to research them. 1993, they opened the like institute for that. And the Americans come there like asking or awakening Europeans to go out to fight for their genetically most capable cultural cultivation manner to come again, Asians which are like flourishing. And something which is probably premier for you, because it was premier for me, it's even better in the Swedish, reading some. It explains how we see this graduation of the far north to the far south. Behold my child, the Nordic man, and be like him as you can. His legs are long, his mind is slow, his hair is length and made of tow. And there, and here we have the Alpine race. Oh, what a broad and dirty face was. He is the most unpleasant fellow, the most degraded of them all. And listen now, Mediterranean we call, his hair is crisp and even crude, and he is so sick with the girls. Curls, and he is so sick with the girls. 1939, very interesting to see graduation, and it is even more like child song in Swedish, it's like la 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 la. But something is like hiding under. We know that Nordic countries is like partly collaborating with Germany. Actually, which was for me quite new, Pan-Germanism, which started in 1930s, was like a national, they would like to somehow involve Scandinavians to fight in their names. Why? Because they are over class. But the Scandinavians were like, we are researching and don't have idea to support Punch Germany. It's like historical part because they are like a little bit, I guess, in language you can find a struggle in a lot of economically. Germany is like a very, how can I say, separated neighbor. they like each other, but with a distance. So they don't agree with Hitler in that time. So Hitler had a problem. And he actually found out it would be wrong to fight against the successful racial research, block Germans from touring against Scandinavians, just because they're then fighting as the biggest and dangerous enemy. So he put them like neutral. Don't move, we will not do anything, but give us space to work. So Finland became like this and Norway, because they are like, historically, it's a misuse, I don't know, we don't need to speak there, but Sweden is like neutral, but they open the space for them to work, because otherwise Germany would just come. So it is not, it's very, they don't like to speak about it. some another perspective is Protestantism. Martin Luther, 1517, protested against the church, Catholics, and he puts his 95 theses. 23, King Gustav Vasa, together with Danish people, I find that online, actually defeated or fight against the Catholic monasteries, killed the monks, and using the money to build the state. There is no money to build the state in that time. And Danish was like a very, very hard enemy, so they did it. So Protestantism is some very special perspective of Christianity, which is also a huge part of how they relate to let's say, literature and everything else, which is kind of even not ignored. And something, crusades, yes or no, I'm not history, but I'm the Knight Templar. Did somebody saw that movie? It's quite okay, they were so critically, we are not crusades, we didn't do that, we were so poor, we couldn't do that. But there is a story about that. Nordic noir in literature, I was just like this crime. It becomes, after the Second World War, through this Stig Ternet, Stockholm's Mysteries, but 16th and 19th put the socio-critical attitude. You are not killing because it is like specially mystic in some fictional way. They act like actively, they take activism through that, speaking about feminism, speaking about social inequality on lots of levels. So crime is not just easy crime, entertaining one. It's also like activist through the police procedure, establish like Sweden or all North country. In that, why is North Dakota special from this crime? Because they are doing something. Millennium Trilogy, you saw the movie probably, The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. It's part of this trilogy. The same pattern. Stieg Larsson was loyal, and he put all this inequality injustice in this trilogy. So it is like tough with this level and female character, Nomira Paz, who is fighting and things like that. So questions: how this, which is from one, let's say, small speaking area, becomes so huge and popular around the world. So he's dealing exactly the same thing with that. Mankell, Henning Mankell, is one who is like the father of this today known with the detective Wallander. Did you saw this TV series? I saw it here. I have it hard to watch it because Wallander is everywhere in Sweden, and I don't like so much TV series, because it's quite far away from art, which I'm searching to see, or deeper meaning when I'm seeing some kind of art. But himself is he's made this Wallander, which is like a very normal, naive Swedish guy who is like doing things outside the road, and he's actually opened the window to the Sweden society and everything. He's not interesting to travel. He's not interesting. He don't care about that. But he gives some another perspective of the Sweden, which we don't know. And he said, if you put in Greek tragedy like Medea, police, you have crime history. You don't ask. He is like dealing with that, like possible dialogue, solidarity, in cosmopolitan vision across the multiple worlds and times. So crime from Swedish perspective is something which open quite huge perspective, just if we take a right subject. Here we can take Kierkegaard, which is theologist, but he's a philosopher, God of existence, father of existence in Islam, in a philosophy. And Emanuel Swedenborg, probably you know him, he's like the old religion. He's Christian, but Mother Nature. Because Sweden or Norden is like much more dependent on nature, and their paganism is more present than in the rest of Europe. They have like pagan names of weekdays, streets, Torgatan, Torsgatan, Freygatan, Valhalla, Vegan. It's all the names of pagan, which we, for example, here, we just don't know about Perun or Vesna. So. And here's also interesting to see probably like fairy tales, folk, for this national songs and this heritage, how it sounds. And it sounds, they always have the, like a bit of darkness. For this analysis, I took a balanced ground, narrative, modernist establishment, or the genre is not existing in modernism because obviously we are not are running away from genre. Landscape, stylistic pattern. I will not dive so much in there, but minimalism, which is also part of the dogma manifestation from 1995. What is dogma? Dogma is answer to the Hollywood. We don't need, because they put this, I researched this, independent, and they actually did independent movie, but they sell it like, this is Weinstein, the guy who did the mess. He just sell it to the huge Hollywood, Pulp Fiction, Piano, it's his products, sex lies and videotapes. He just take a small movie and then packaged it as a business, I mean like entertainment. And the directors feel like they're, you're stealing. It is not, our movie is not entertainment. It's quite, but he did it. So Lars von Trier, together with this guy, said, okay, it's enough with the Hollywood in any level. Nothing, we have no light, no nothing. I mean, you have camera, actors, natural light, and everything is at low, low, low. We are going there. So, and this kind of pattern we can almost see in these movies that I'm doing a study over. Chronotype, unpredictability, and so on. This is this subject which I was following. And conclusion, just to let you know, modernism is new destructive, unconditional, as old and protected, right? Creates a logical antagonism, but with the reverse directions, it is something which is not for modernism. All civilizational heritage become destructive, but everything which is already real is destructive, but the new barbarian, call it, actually builds. But it is something which comes as a new barbarian to put in between. So otherness and other, actually, if we are watching in more deep this research case study, we will find out that otherness is actually turned to ourselves. So they are seeing otherness in themselves, like animal within themselves. It's not coming outside, it's coming within us. In this way, the third wave of modernism is destruction of chain of Viking heritage, racism, colonialism, and neoliberalism in establishing the new, old, known Nordic identity. And you can find Ruben Östlund, Triangle of Sadness, is actually examining anti-colonialism, everything which is problem which we are dealing here on this conference. He's questioning that, he's giving this Filipinian girl like under position working down there, but suddenly he's up there. He's one very clever guy. He's like almost mathematically taking social problems and making movie of something which is almost impossible, but he managed it and winning second can just one after, maybe two years or 3 years in a row. Before was like a square, if you remember. It's also art, questioning art and a lot of relation. He is a quite, follow this guy. He's thinking very special. And Winterberg, surely with a great guy, Madsen. We are lucky. He just thinking, he's a dancer. Think about it. He's moving, so he's also one special guy to have in front of the camera. And he put, you know, very questionable impression of alcoholism, white men, and things like that. Everybody said, you're crazy, you cannot come nowhere with this, but he won the Cannes and Oscar, if I remember. So, Nordic film engagement in collective Nordic imaginary offer not existential depression, as on TV series, rather life internal struggle that seeks a deeper individual social meaning transparency against prohibitions, hindrance offered by social prejudice and state laws. They're out of laws. They're crazy about laws. You cannot buy the alcohol when you want. You cannot do this and that. So they are like this huge, I assume, high standard. Also have its cost, which we have, let's say, here. The chain of regulation through the almost non-visible form of crime. Crime is visible, but not as a, I'm going to do that. But crime is present. The guy is dying in a sea in this way. The boat is exploding. Somebody is disappearing there. So we have crime. The question, time of the question where the police will come. Reefers life circled by the being back. Coming back to the meaning of the life. Therefore, NORDIC is not the hopeless and dark, senseless or serial slaughter. Rather, the deepest existential expression of the perpetual vivid social theme, renewing creativity of Northern Europe, which is important to approach to collecting NOIR images, NORDIC NOIR as genre. It's not just do whatever we want, as we have this theory series, because now it's flourishing in Serbia. Thousands and thousands of TV series, which I'm just watching. Where are we going now? It is wrong. You must deal with something. You must send some idea about what are you doing. So, and the last one is thank you.
There are some examples. For example, me and Zaki,
bicultural movie and so on. It's also like it's already embedded in his movies, like this, like motion, not so much action in his cartoons. Yeah. So like to look for already present examples if there are, like this one, this author, and to see what are the like to research potential and to deliver this potential to this movement.
Someone from India or from
party country as like gods, you know, like it's everything is the best standard, healthy child education, and every single part which I mentioned here has a problem, which we don't have, which we don't know from here perspective, from this perspective. So I said like this, no, I don't want to, because we don't have the Sweden. I'm talking mostly about Sweden because Sweden is somehow the heart of these Nordic countries. They are, as I mentioned, colonial, not as England, I mean last 200 years, when we find out these theories which we are using today. So if I don't have ground here, why should, it's a Griffith is my source, and he is very, I asked the guy from Politic, what shall I speak about colonialism, I mean, how to reach that, just because like colonialism is something which is a common theory, which is just flourishing, and you can speak about colonialism, drinking this water, you can speak about everything, but I have no ground there, like in more common sense of talking about colonialism, to speak then post-colonialism, to speak then decolonialism, they are in some kind of, like, but is it colonialism? More is like racism, nationalism, Nazi somewhere. I think that I will find there more ground to, how do you say, dive in research. Colonialism is something which is already, I use Mohanty, feminism. We can speak here about, I took two guys, I just really missing girls, and I put in the PhD, we will have the girls also, filmmakers, coming on the level which is also big, not Austria, not Canada. So I'm not sure the colonial way, if you're talking about Carl Bildt, you know, he's one who is dealing factories here and there, still selling, today he's selling weapon to probably Russia, you know? And we are talking about NATO, and we are talking about conflict, and we are talking about double moral, and we are talking, I will put here this because I found the one book where is today is running business with this. Nobody is mentioning that. Why? My resource is not so, how can I say, stable. I mean, I must check what is this book about, but people are talking about that, so something happens. So I will take this perspective, but I will call it more like not colonialism, like more double moral, and find more theoretically things which are, and my authors here are Swedes mostly, because we must understand that, and I put here, they are naive. We are talking about Nordic countries from our perspective, which is south, which we are common to deal with the north, west, south, east, at least we're in the Balkan. We don't know from which part we are like taken. There, you're just with the white bears, you know, there. And probably Russia come from time to time. So they're not having this kind of sharpness as we have here. Like, okay, take care about it. They're like naive. They are believing because they have this like Aryan something which, but they are historically didn't have a problem, you know, just
they did. I mean, 17th century, it's like, there it is.
12th century too, I mean, Vikings and things like that. Historically, yes, but...
But that's colonial.
Okay, yes, please. At the risk of laboring the point, I do feel like it has to be said. So, when you talk about this slow movement, as somebody who was born and raised in a village, where, and I live there now, I've chosen to leave what is supposedly the center, which is Cape Town,